Good evening and welcome to the College of Complexes. Tonight, we're going to be talking about the Brady Bill and gun control violence. The College of Complexes has been around since 1951. My name is Tim and our speaker has not shown up tonight yet. So what we're going to do is we're going to run a quick 13-minute video from the president of the Brady Bill campaign. I'll then expository a little bit on gun control violence. We'll then take our traditional question and answer period questions, and then we'll let you guys go into an extended rebuttal or debates. Just to briefly review, if you haven't been here before, we have a brief announcements period, then our speaker speaks, which will be our video, and then myself, expository on gun violence. And then we'll have questions and answers for me or whoever's in the thing. If our speaker shows, we'll let him have the microphone.
The video itself says, it doesn't matter whether you love or hate guns. It is obvious the U.S. would be a safer place if there weren't thousands of them sold every day without background checks. Dan Gross, president of the Brady Campaign to Prevent Gun Violence, makes a passionate personal appeal for something more than 90% of Americans want: background checks for gun sales. For every great movement around the world, there's a moment where you can look back and say, that's when things really started to change. Gross says, for a movement to end gun violence in America, that moment is here. This is from a video called Technology, Entertainment, and Design. It's otherwise known as TED Talks. They have a lot of other things up and over a number of other videos. So let's get started and watch this 13-minute video by Dan Gross.
Okay, so confession. I've always been weirdly obsessed with advertising. I remember watching Saturday morning cartoons, paying more attention to the commercials than to the shows, trying to figure out how they were trying to get inside my head. Ultimately, that led me to my dream job. I became a partner at a big New York eddy. Then all of that suddenly changed on February 23rd, 1997, when my little brother, Matt, was shot in the head in a shooting that happened on the observation deck of the Empire State Building. Suddenly, my family was thrown into the middle of a nightmare, being told that my brother was going to die, actually being given the opportunity to say goodbye to him, then several emergency brain surgeries, and now what's amounted for Matt to a lifetime spent courageously recovering from a traumatic brain injury. Definitely my hero. But as much as he deserves it. But as much as this tragedy was a nightmare for my family, I often think about how much worse it could have been, in fact, how much worse it is for the 90 families every day who are as fortunate to lose loved ones, brothers, sisters, sons, daughters, parents. They don't all make national headlines. In fact, most of them don't. They go largely unnoticed. And a nation kind of come to accept a disgraceful national epidemic as some kind of new normal. So I quit my job in advertising to try and do something about this disgraceful national epidemic, because I came to realize that the challenges to preventing gun violence are actually the same ones that made me love advertising, which is to try to figure out how to engage people, only instead of doing it to sell products, doing it to save lives. And that comes down to finding common ground, where what I want overlaps with what you want. And you might be surprised to learn, when it comes to gun violence, just how much common ground there is. Let's look, for example, at people who love to hunt. Sport enjoyed by millions across the U.S. A proud tradition, families. In some places, the first day of hunting season is actually a school holiday. What do hunters want? Well, they want to hunt. They love their guns. They believe deeply in the Second Amendment right to own those guns, but that doesn't mean that there isn't common ground. In fact, there's a lot of it, starting with the basic idea of keeping guns out of dangerous hands. This isn't about taking certain guns away from all people. It's about keeping all guns away from certain people, and it's the people that it turns out we all agree shouldn't have guns: convicted violent criminals, domestic abusers, the dangerously mentally ill. We can all appreciate how Brady background checks have been incredibly effective in keeping guns out of those dangerous hands. In 20 years, Brady background checks at federally licensed firearm dealers have blocked 2.4 million gun sales to those people that we all agree shouldn't have guns. And whether you love guns or hate guns, you probably also appreciate that there shouldn't be thousands of gun sales every day at gun shows or online without those Brady background checks. Just like there shouldn't be two lines to get on an airplane, one with security and one with no security. And the numbers show the overwhelming agreement among the American public. 90% of Americans support expanded Brady background checks to all gun sales, including 90% of Republicans, more than 80% of gun owners, more than 70% of NRA members. This is not a controversial idea. In fact, only 6% of the American public disagrees. That's about the percentage of the American public that believes that the moon landing was a fake. And it's also about the percentage that believes that the government is putting mind-controlling technology in our TV broadcast signals. That's the extent to which we agree about background checks. But what about the 300 million guns already out there in homes across America? Well, first, it's important to realize that those guns are mostly in the hands and homes of decent, law-abiding people like you and me, who want what we all want, including keeping our families safe. In fact, that's why more and more people are choosing to own guns. 10 years ago, 42% of the American public believed that a gun incorrectly makes your home safer. Today, that number is 63%. Why? Well, I kind of hate to say, because it gets to the dark underbelly of advertising, which is, if you tell a big enough lie enough times, eventually that lie becomes the truth, and that's exactly what's happened here. The corporate gun lobby has spent billions of dollars blocking the CDC from doing research into the public health epidemic of gun violence, blocking pediatricians from talking to parents about the dangers of guns in the home, blocking smart gun technology and other technology that would prevent kids from firing parents' guns and would save lives. They're desperate to hide the truth because they view the truth as a threat to their bottom line. And every day, people are dying as a result. And a lot of those people are children. Every day in the US, 9 kids are just shot unintentionally. 900 children and teens take their own lives every year. And here's the thing, they're almost all with a parent's gun. Even 2/3 of school shootings happen with a gun taken from the home, including the terrible tragedy at Sandy Hook. I meet so many of these parents. It's the most heartbreaking part of my job. These are not bad people. They're just living with the unimaginable consequences of a very bad decision made based on very bad information that was put into their minds by very bad people who know good and well the misery that they're causing, but just don't care. And the result is a nightmare, not only for families like me, but for really, at the end of the day, all of us. But I'm not here to talk about the nightmare of gun violence. I'm here to talk about our dream, and it's a dream we all share, which is the dream of a better, safer future. For my organization, for the Brady Campaign, that dream is reflected in the bold goal to cut the number of gun deaths in the U.S. in half by 2025, and I hope to leave all of you here tonight with a strong sense of exactly why that dream is so absolutely within reach. Because folks, for every great movement around the world, there's a moment where you can look back and say, that's when things really start to change. And I'm here to say that for the movement to end gun violence in America, that moment is here.
Stephanie Chris.
clear so clearly at a tipping point, because the American public has come together by the millions like never before, based on that common ground, to say enough. Enough of the mass shootings in malls and movie theaters and churches and schools. Enough of the daily terror of gun violence that in homes and streets that's claiming the lives of women and young black men in staggering proportions. Enough of easy access to guns by the people that we all agree shouldn't have them. And enough of a small group of craven politicians putting the interests of the corporate gun lobby ahead of the people that they have been elected to represent. Enough. And the really exciting thing is, it's not just the usual suspects like me that are saying it anymore. It's so much bigger than that. And if you want proof, let's start where most conversations in the U.S. seem to start, with Kim Kardashian. And here's the thing, it's not really a joke. I mean, think about when issues change. It's when they go from being political issues and advocacy issues to being part of pop culture. Voices coming from everywhere. Celebrities using their platforms. Musicians, athletes, the NBA has come forward. Conservative pundits that you never would have imagined have come forward. You know, there's real cultural change. I even hear there's a TED talk about it this year. I mean, that's the extent to which this cultural change is happening. And yes, Kim Kardashian has made an unsolicited, passionate appeal to her 35 million Twitter followers for expanded background checks. Let's look at the political elections that are heating up. You know, this used to be the classic third rail issue for Democrats. Couldn't run from it fast enough. Now candidates are running on it. Some are being forced to reverse very bad positions they defended very comfortably until very recently. You know, for somebody like me, you know, watching people wave around their negative NRA ratings, it's almost surreal to watch. We're still outfunded, yes, by the corporate gun lobby, right. And ultimately, that needs to change. But you know what? We're smarter, and we're scrappier, and we have the truth on our side, and we're on offense. You know, they say that the internet democratizes information. Social media and some of the organizing tools that plug into it have democratized activism. It's allowed us to show what 90% support really looks like. Sometimes I think of it, you know, we're converging and attacking instantly by the way. It's kind of like white blood cells. You know, it's enabled us to start to really close, and this is the bottom line, close that disgraceful disconnect between what the American public wants and what our elected leaders are doing about it. Until recently, the narrative in Congress was that calls from the other side, from that 6%, outnumbered calls from our side, 10-1. We're flipping that narrative on its head. After that recent terrible tragedy in San Bernardino, we jammed congressional switchboards. We put 15,000 calls into Congress in 24 hours. And you know what? Nobody thought was going to see the light of day anytime soon. We're seeing real movement to repeal some of the most evil, ugly gun lobby legislation passed over the last dark decade. The stranglehold of the gun lobby is clearly being broken. We've seen President Obama's historic executive actions. They don't go all the way, but they are going to save lives because they expand Brady background checks to thousands of gun sales that didn't have them previously. And we are marching across the country. We're not just waiting for Congress back. That would almost be the definition of insanity. We're marching across the country, state by state, marriage equality style. And you know what? We're winning. Congress is almost always the last to wake up and realize that it's on the wrong side of history. And when they do, it's always because the American public shakes them. And that's exactly what we're doing right now, as we're in this tipping point. You know, recently I was flying cross-country to give a speech to a large group like this, although far less intimidating, and the woman sitting next to me happened to be binge-watching one of my all-time favorite TV shows, Mad Men, a period TV show about advertising in the 1960s. And as I was trying to think about how to end my remarks, I glance up at her screen every now and then, and seeing that every time I did, I'd see somebody smoking in an office, or around children, or while pregnant, or drinking and driving, or driving without seatbelts, or sexually harassing a coworker. And ultimately, it dawned on me, what tremendous inspiration for those of us who have this dream to end gun violence. I mean, think about how much the world has changed in a relatively short period of time. How all those behaviors that were once considered commonplace or normal, some even glamorous or sexy, have become stigmatized in just a generation or two once they became conversations about our common ground. That is the magnitude of the change we have the potential to create around gun violence. And that's my dream, that maybe someday some period TV show will depict the terrible nightmare of gun violence, and a future generation of children might only be able to imagine how terrible it must have been. Thank you.
There you have it. It's the it's our president of the Brady campaign to end gun violence. Now I'm going to share with you a story that I have not shared publicly before about it, because when I was in high school, a friend of a friend committed suicide with his father's gun. I don't want to name the name of the person, but it did cause at Henry D. Jacobs High School way back in 1979. The kid woke up, he was really depressed, a girl just dumped him. He went down to his father's basement, unlocked his father's gun case, took a shotgun, put it in his mouth, and pulled the trigger, and his father found him stone cold dead in his den. Now, I'm not saying that that could have been prevented, but perhaps maybe a little bit more of gun safety locks, maybe a little bit more of a firearms training and safety could have been around and taken care of. Perhaps maybe a little bit more of the what the NRA used to do about firearm safety classes could be brought in. I don't have a problem with a person owning a gun. It's, however, I do have a problem with anybody owning a gun. I think you need to be trained. You need to take some safety classes. If you're going to be getting a concealed carry permit, you better know what the heck you're doing and at least take about 20 hours of firearms training to know how to use it and when not to. Also, I'm in firm agreement that the firearms industry is quite exempt from our liability laws today. And if I think we would see a lot change much, much faster if they were held to the same standards that any other producer of a consumer product would be held to. Mm-hmm. Now, personally, I don't own a gun. I really don't want to own a gun in my home, because there would have been maybe way too many times that I would have been depressed and probably have taken my own life at some point or another, especially in my early 20s. I do know some people who handle guns and handle them very responsibly. A couple of families at my church, for example, are avid hunters. Their kids are trained in gun safety. They know they take them out to a range and practice every so often. They do have them in their homes for security purposes. But, you know, he's right about one thing. There's a big more proliferation of gun dealers and gun sales all over the place. As a matter of fact, out in the suburbs, there's some newer gun shops that are on billboards that are, you know, saying, hey, you want to own firearms, or conducting training classes. And even a place called Tavern at the Bridge, where I may go indulge in a drink, one day shut the tavern down to conduct the concealed carry safety class. I really don't know what it will take, but I do know that, yes, people with guns kill people. Guns don't kill people, but guns do. However, a lot of people say guns are a tool. But most tools are useful for something else. A gun is made for killing people or killing animals. It's a useful tool for law enforcement, for government, and yes, for people to protect themselves given the right set of circumstances. Personally, though, we are awash in firearms. We see it happen all the time on the south side of Chicago with many other things. And I just cannot see
the purpose myself of not of having a gun, but not taking care of, the, of it properly with a safe or a gun lock or something else. So I would recommend two things at the end of this talk. Number one, enforce the Brady campaign bill for, you know, the gun show loophole. And the second thing I would do is lift the liability disclaimers off the gun industry itself. Make them accountable for the same standards that any other consumer product would have. Now, I know that our speaker didn't show up tonight, but I hope I've given at least an impassioned talk on gun control and my certain things about it. I have looked at this issue myself. I am, you know, I'm a military man from the Navy. I've shot 45s. And I'll tell you, when I went to the range, I was very petrified of shooting because I knew what a gun could do.
What?
And there are these people that were there just kind of casually handling them and familiar with it. But I just felt very uneasy about carrying one, about having one, and the power that they could use to kill. I really hope tonight that we can get a very good, solid consideration for this. Now, I would like to entertain questions on this issue. If I can answer them. Yes, Charlie.
I'd like to speak on this issue.
Please, Charlie, come on up and speak.
That old boy, Charlie.
Yeah, let's talk to Charlie. You better than that.
Go ahead, Charlie. Come on, Charlie. Let's talk on it.
I am, in fact, a member of the Brady campaign against handgun violence. I've been actively involved in gun control issues for at least for 25 years and have been recognized by the Illinois Coalition for Handgun Violence for my volunteer efforts. I have at least 10 to 12 people who are gun advocates who regularly give me a hard time on emails, and I exchange with them and give them an equal hard time. I'm also a member of the, amazingly enough, Illinois Moms Against Guns.
All right.
And regularly participate in that organization. I've also testified and like to think I was instrumental in trying to keep guns off of the public transit system of this city, which we succeeded in doing despite the legislation. And I'll be eclectic as usual on a number of things here. There's a mass shooting, if you define this as 3 to 5 individuals perishing. There's a mass shooting in the United States every week and has been for about, well, I have less than my luck, probably for about 2 years. The Illinois Coalition for the Handgun Violence produces, and I believe it's still up on the website, about a 200-page thing of statistics if you want to get into this issue and think issues, my statistics versus your statistics. He's right that 9 children, the other statistic that does come to mind is that every day in the United States, a gun is brought to an elementary or high school in the United States and is taken away from a student. This is clearly a problem. I don't know where they get the idea that hunting is a sport. I've been involved in the green effort and environmental thing. I've hiked the Appalachian Trail, and not once during that endeavor did I ever feel the compelling need to kill something. I lived in rural areas, and as a matter of fact, the opening of hunting season was a very hazardous time for the communities and the residents of rural areas. Bullets travel for a mile or two. I can, if you want anecdotes, the neighbor farmer was shot by a young kid. Inadvertently, I don't think they were aiming at it, A bullet went through the window of my bookmobile while I was parked. These are the incidences. This is not isolated incidences. This happens all the time. My neighbor, I was in the backyard having some guests over. The trees above me started falling down, branches. And I ascertained that it was the neighbor kid who was having some fun with the weapon that his dad gave him to amuse himself with. And these were, it's like in the country, your neighbor is a mile or two away. Nevertheless, the branches were falling down. There's some silly notions that you need weapons to fight totalitarianism. And if you took away all the guns, the United States would become a totalitarian state. And this is the first thing that Adolf Hitler did. Well, gun control has been in effect in several countries around the world for decades, and they have not become totalitarian countries. Now, the other thing is, do you think the guys in my neighborhood are going to stand up against a trained military force, such as the United States Army, a regular combat force? That's absolutely nonsensical. There's also some things, even if you want to use this German story, Eisenhower would never put the American soldiers up in a combat situation against a trained German army unless they had a decidedly 2-to-1 advantage, because they were in fact very good at what they did. Now, I often heard, if only we had guns in Germany, we could have taken over the Wehrmacht, the German army. That's absolutely nonsensical. That's not going to happen. That would not have happened. This was a good army, and the best that the armies in the world were unsuccessful against it. And to say that a civilian population is going to somehow be better than a trained military force in combating them is a height of total absurdity and nonsense, and apparently spouted by people who have absolutely no concept of history. Spouted out that it automatically become a totalitarian government and this. Now, the other thing is, in our own Constitution, regarding the civilian soldiers versus the established government, the American Revolution, the Second Amendment, there's some notion that, oh, they needed guns to because they wanted to oppose the government. The oddest thing is, the one thing they did learn from the American Revolution was that the militia units, the Minutemen, if you so to speak, were absolutely no good. I spoke on this at the college conferences. Absolutely no good in combating a regular standing army. George Washington knew this. He spent several years putting together a regular army. They would have the militia show up and maybe take a few shots here or there from the trees. They said, take a shot or two, boys, and then you can do what you want. But it was a regular army, the regular U.S. colonial army that Washington developed, that stood up against the British. And they knew the war was going to continue. One of the reasons the British were going to give up on the effort is because the American army, the trained professional soldiers of the colonial army, would stay in battle for hours all day. There were battles that they not only stood up against the British, didn't run, they weren't afraid of bayonets like the militia. They stood up toe-to-toe for hours and actually bettered them. And then the British said, this is what the British decided. They said, we are not going to win this conflict. We can't win battles anymore. He has put together an army. And with the aid of the French, they were able to do it. So the notion that this country needed militia soldiers is contrary to everything that is about the history of the colonial movement. I recommend you read any book on this. you'll find out the militia unit were of absolutely no value whatsoever towards winning the American Revolution. They might have had one or two battles at the beginning, but that was it. That was not going to succeed against British regulars, all of whom had 10 more years experience on average, and were with the well, best equipped, best trained army on earth. You weren't going to, this is some mythology that the citizen soldier was going to defeat them. No, that did not happen. I'm sorry, it's nice to think that it did, but it didn't. So getting your own guns and standing up isn't going to work. Training. Oh, all we do is get training, and it's suddenly a gun is safe. Well, what are you going to do? Tim, you want to give guns to kids, and you've ever heard of a concept called maturity? This is a thing that gives instant death.
Yes.
It doesn't select. Whoever pointed at, they die. So this is maturity. And you say, well, this is the fallacy of training. It's the solution to everything. Education is the solution to everything, right? Any social problem we have, we'll just have training. Education, right?
Okay.
This is the progressive thought in the 20s. Everything, if we only had education, everybody, people wouldn't be racist. We'll just give them training. Right? We'll just make good citizens by education. So training is it. Now you give my loony neighbor, how much training are you going to, my loony neighbor, who likes weapons, is nuts, stupid. You're going to give him training. What's that going to achieve? Is that going to make my life safer? And then he gives his access to the guns to his loony kids. And they can get any, now does that help my life? Now public safety is an inherent function of government. I'm sorry, folks, not the individual.
Okay.
And right, no right is exercised in the absolute. Oh, I need the gun for my personal safety, but the safety of the community can just go off and disappear. No, that's not how it works, man. No, the public safety inherently by trained personnel is how it works. That's the problem. Now, the real problem we got, anybody, is the thing is that gun laws don't mean anything unless you can infect them nationwide. Because all you got to do to get a gun is what? Go to Indiana? Whatever. There's a black market and things like this. You got to have nationwide ban on this. Now, the amazing thing is the United States, I don't understand it. We've had episode after a shooting, and we've never done anything about it. It's inconceivable. Why that the people don't demand change in it, I don't know. But to say that you're gonna, now the other thing is insurance. I like this, people, conceal carry, yeah. Go and conceal carry, oh, this is great. If you use that concealed carry weapon, it will cost you at least $100,000
yep.
in court costs. Guaranteed. Mm-hmm. Not just liability against the gun guy. You, the gun owner. You know. Anyhow, that's basically it. Sorry I'm ranting and raving on you. But yeah, this is a nonsensical thing.
Okay.
You know, anyhow, thank you very much. I think I covered it.
Charlie, are you familiar?
Yes. Yeah.
Stay up here.
Turn in your guns. Turn in your guns.
Oh, boy, Charlie.
Yeah.
No, I have heard
turn in your guns.
That Australia recently enacted, a few years ago, recently enacted gun control legislation. They had a nationwide program of turning them in, and that they were banned in like urban areas, and that if you wanted a gun, you had to prove a need to have one, such as being in the outback, or maybe you had some security or some overriding issue. But after they did that, they said gun deaths went down, and you know, we're one of the few industrialized countries that allows these types of gun issues to go in. So anyway, I think right now, let's entertain some questions. Charlie, if you want to come on up and try to get from the thing. How about this? Why don't we just go into rebuttals straight away?
Well, let's go to questions.
All right, well, if you want some questions, we can do that.
You got questions?
Yeah, Charlie, what are we supposed to do?
Huh?
All right.
What do you want to do?
The question was, what do you want to do, get rid of the Second Amendment?
Charlie?
What's
wrong with that?
It's all of this is subject to interpretation.
Mike, Charlie.
Certainly the Constitution is a legal something written in legal, and it's subject to interpretation. That amendment, if necessary, basic interpretation worked pretty good. This is why the composition of the court. I'm not a constitutional scholar, but you had some bad decisions. I don't think the dust has settled on that yet. Second Amendment, I disagree with some of the decisions. It may be overturned tomorrow, may be overturned next week. The old notion is, what happened was, of course, the ruling was for years that it was interpreted. You have to read the whole thing. It says, in order to provide a militia, it begins. And so they said, of course, if the militia provides you with a rifle, you don't need to have your own. Now, every militia, even in colonial times, had what is called an arsenal. And that's why they have them around the state of Illinois and other states. So that if you go there, they give you, if you're in the Illinois National Guard, they give you a gun, so you don't really need your own. And then was it the Miller case, where the guy said, no, that's not it, and you had a conservative majority that said, no, this guy wanted to have it in his house, and this militia thing, and somehow that language didn't exist. I don't know why, which is ridiculous, but that's the decision. So you could wait to see how it is. And then again, even within the, however you interpret that, that doesn't mean that local communities are prohibited from enacting their own legislation. Perhaps not to the extent that they used to, but it didn't stop us from keeping weapons off public transit. So there, I succeeded. Maybe I'm just good at,
Okay.
Are you saying this second?
All right.
No guns on CTA.
Before.
There are no guns before. No guns now.
I just recently pulled up an article. It says Australian data shows gun control a huge success 20 years after a mass shooting. I'm not exactly sure what they did, but the statistics, the chances of being murdered by a gun in Australia plunged from 0.15 per 100,000 people in 2014 from 0.54 per 100,000 people in 1996, which is the decline of about 72%. In 1996, Australia had 311 murders, of which 98 were with guns. In 2014, with a population up from about 18 million to 23 million, Australia had about 238 murders, of which 35 were with guns. It was the April 28th, 1996 shooting deaths by a lone gunman of 35 people in and around a cafe at a historic former prison colony in Tasmania that prompted the government to buy back or confiscate 1 million firearms and make it harder to buy new ones.
There's some countries like England that get like 9 gun deaths a year. That's been going on for decades.
There's so many guns around.
Well, here we got 9 children shot a day. They have 9 gun deaths in a year. But there's some, I guess there's an argument that's not a goal we should strive for. That there's something that is, I can't figure out if there's an argument that's not something that we shouldn't try to do as collectively, is to not have 9 shootings a day, to 9 per year. That sounds like pretty good to me, you know? Good social policy, you know? But I guess there's arguments against you. I don't know how. You got people dead or children? Or
all right.
Yeah, what about Switzerland? I mean, you know, I understand in Switzerland everybody's required to have a gun. You know,
that's
so
crazy. That's
is it true or not?
Yes.
I don't know.
Libertarians
try to say everyday citizens army concepts.
I mean,
that is nonsensical.
Is it a fact that everyone in Switzerland is required to have a gun in their home?
From what I understand, for the purposes of serving in the army,
yes.
Something along that line.
Okay, but they all have guns. So, since they all have guns, how do the statistics in Switzerland compare?
I don't honestly remember. I can get you that book. If you're trying to argue that you can have guns and not gun violence, that's not going to work. There's no place where guns, it doesn't work here. You can't, as a matter of fact, I just sent that around that I don't send around emails about incidences because there's too many of them and they're too dark. But I only send the one that they get where there are no guns, there's no gun violence. That's an indisputable statistical fact. I'll send it to you. I saw it still on my list of emails. Where you have no guns, it's very simple. There's no gun violence.
Right, but it
and where you have guns,
it doesn't
you, what
remove
part of
violence,
that don't you understand?
It doesn't remove violence, it only removes gun violence. If somebody wants to kill somebody, they can do it with a baseball bat, a knife, a slingshot,
All right. We're not going to achieve Denver a perfect society, but believe you me, given the carnage that we're facing and the value of human life, This is a weapon. This is designed for instant death. This will blow your head off. It will blow my head off, my loony neighbor. Lois used to make me, I told this story many times. Lois used to, her cat would get out, and she'd say, Charles, you have to go find the cat. And I said, that nutcase thinks his castle concept. He might think I'm a burglar and kill me. Now, this is my neighbor. And she'd say, Charles, go get that cat. And I said, you got to be kidding me. This is like 3 o'clock in the morning. I'm going to show who's going to get my house. I got my gun ready. Now tell me that if you're presenting some argument that there's what? I don't want violence in the world. But believe you me, there's irrefutable fact that there's less in degree and extent of violence without guns in communities. That's clearly, I don't even know why you need to prove that. Do you want a community where people can have weapons to hurt each other versus a community? Is this your purpose of promise?
Yes,
I got to choose between a community where they don't have weapons. Now, don't you understand that people get like in arguments and fights or road rage? You don't know about road rage. You never heard of this. You never heard of disputes where neighbors, where husbands pull out. You never heard of that. Let me tell you a story. You want a story? All right, I'm going to tell you a story right here in my neighborhood. Right down the block. Right down the block where I got started in this. Teenagers getting an argument. The kid goes home, right up the block. My family, relative. Got dad's gun. Drove around. Shot the other kid. 17 years old. Is that the kind of community you want? Do you want that kind of going? Oh, but guns don't cause any violence. No, what do you think it did to that family? What do you think it did to that family? It shattered their only son. We need this in our life. We need this in our world. They needed that. Just think how different their life would have been if the guy had not purchased a gun and put it in his house and had ammo.
Do you think that kids would have had a little maybe argument or call each other names or even had a little thing? But no, they had elevated it into firepower. For every example, there's a counter example. You know, why are you drinking? Oh yeah, they're saved lives. I love those. Well, Grandma shot the intruder, right? Those stories, I like those. Grandma plugged the intruders. All right, what's going on, Wes?
So there's a 20-hour course on the correct way to use a gun.
They think gun training, but I wouldn't take a course where they can probably, they get people, I guess they give guns to everybody and then they say learn how to use these. I don't think I'd want to be near there, but I mean, there actually have been some tragic incidences. But as I say, these are, training is not some omnibus kind of thing that somebody inculcates like perfect logic or reason, or, you know, perfect judgment suddenly. You know, you take a 20-hour course and you have instant intelligence or something. I don't know what course it is. I'd like to take it myself, you know. All right, anything else? Am I being too rough on you guys?
I pulled up an interesting article, Charlie, that it's about Switzerland. And it says a Swiss difference, a gun culture that works. The country had one mass shooting in 2001, but the resulting anti-gun referendum failed to pass. The Swiss will not give up the gun. Can their cold system work in the U.S.? The article goes on to say, even as the gun control debate again in the U.S. in the aftermath of the horrific school shooting in Newton, Connecticut, the gun-loving Swiss are not about to lay down their arms. Guns are ubiquitous in this neutral nation, with sharp shooting considered a fun and wholesome recreational activity for people of all ages. Even though Switzerland has not been involved in an armed conflict since a standoff between Catholics and Protestants in 1847, the Swiss are very serious about their right to own weapons but also carry them around in public. Because of this general acceptance and even pride in gun ownership, nobody bats an eye at the sight of a civilian riding a bus, bike, or motorcycle through the shooting range with a rifle slung across the shoulder. We'll never change our attitudes about responsible use of weapons by law-abiding citizens, said Herman Sutter, vice president of the Pro Tel, the country's gun lobby, named after the legendary Apple shooter William Tell, who
all
used
right,
the crossbow.
We got that. We know that, but there's one thing you don't have in Switzerland. You don't have militia groups. Now, we could send a few over there. These are people that make gun ownership real interesting. Now, I'm a federal employee, and I'm reading that some militia group showed up and took over a federal building. And I go, oh, this is rather intriguing. Now, why don't we send a few of those over there? Now, I understand. Do you got anything in there that says how many militia groups have come about since? This is the one thing about, I think about guns, huh? Guns are no big deal. I think something like 1,000 militia groups, hate groups, come into existence since Trump got elected. I mean, isn't this something to think about?
I got a question?
So you're saying the Second Amendment was poorly written?
The normal interpretation was that
it's poorly written. It's unclear.
But it's done.
Whichever you wish. I think you should have an amendment that says no guns.
Okay. Here's the second part. What does bearing a gun mean?
That's just having a gun.
All right.
No. Does it mean
all
right, I can carry it here, in the college, into a school, only at home? What does bear mean?
That I don't know.
See, it's poorly written.
All right, good.
All right. Before we move, Charlie, I found out a little bit more about, on the web, the armed takeover of a federal government building in Oregon amid a renewed expansion of far-right anti-government militia movement in the wake of the 2014 standoff between federal agents and heavily armed anti-government activists in the Nevada desert. In its annual count of militias, the Southern Poverty Law Center identified 267 militia groups, up from 202 in 2014, which is a 37% increase. Andy, go ahead.
Hello, my name is Andy Anderson. I've been a regular here since 2007, and I've been given an average of 2 or 3 talks a year here on the American media, what things they cover and what things they don't. And from some of the comments here tonight and on this subject nationwide, we see that Americans are living in a bubble of mythology and not understanding what's going on in other parts of the world. One of the things that you never hear talked about with gun violence in America is there's other countries that are saturated with guns that don't have the kind of gun violence we have. And it's not the guns and the hardware per se, it's the culture. It's the customs of the country, how people are raised, what kind of economic conditions they have. You have to look at the conditions of a particular society. I'd say they don't have school shootings and gun violence and everything like this in Switzerland, Norway, Sweden, any of the Scandinavian countries. Because they look at what it means to be human, what it means to be living in a viable society. Their concept of a viable society is different than the concepts that are foisted upon us by the American media, with the concept that you just let billionaire predators run wild and make as many billions as they can, regardless of who can afford their rent, who can afford their medicine, who doesn't have a job. A whole range of issues contribute to the feeling of hopelessness that a lot of people have when they reach for a gun. And just trying to regulate the hardware itself is not going to change these conditions, and it's not going to cut down the total amount of carnage we have until we start addressing the root causes of why people are doing these kinds of things in the first place. So that's all I would say. Look to other countries. Okay. We have 5% of the world's people in America here. The other 95% are scattered around the planet, and I don't think there's any other country on earth that has the kind of gun violence we do. And in England I haven't really studied it in depth, but I was under the impression that the police in England for a long time didn't even carry guns. They didn't have gun shootings and all kinds of stuff. They had a different kind of culture. And it's when you allow the culture of a society to go downhill to the point where people are reaching for a gun to settle things or just out of depression, you know, these are the kinds of things that lead to suicide, death among teenagers. And also, for those of you that aren't aware of the talk show host Tom Hartman, he's one of the best historians in our country. He's got the most popular talk show on the airwaves, Rush Limbaugh aside. Tom Hartman is highly respected. He's on 8:20 a.m. in Chicago here from 11 to 2. He talks about these social issues all the time. And he said, you know, the suicide rate, they've studied this now for decades. The suicide rate in America goes up when a Republican president is in office. And it goes down when conditions begin to improve, when you have deficits. These are just statistics you can look up. And so our country, more and more people are sensing that our country is at a tipping point, a turning point. And personally, I think my prayers were rewarded when Donald Trump got elected, because he's the biggest middle finger that has ever sat in the Oval Office. And he's a giant middle finger as a wake-up call that Americans need We didn't need another 8 years of the status quo with our congressmen, criminals masquerading as Congress critters, taking billions and just eliminating the middle class. The conditions that you're talking about tonight with gun violence and what leads to it, those conditions would have gotten steadily worse had we not had a huge wake-up call of an election here. So we're seeing predators running wild in this country right now, billionaire predators, and we outnumber them 1,000 to 1. There's a question of what are we going to do as citizens. Each of us, there's 300 million or something, that each of us has a piece of what it means to live in a democracy.
All right.
And so each of us has a piece of the responsibility for what causes gun violence in the first place. Thank you.
Interesting chart I just pulled up about the number of gun deaths per, if the United States had the same population, no other rich Western country comes close.
Yeah.
You know, we do have more gun deaths per capita than other countries, such as Canada, Greece, Luxembourg, Norway, and whatever. And we really can't argue with these statistics because it's a fact. All right. How about we now get into rebuttals?
Tim, is that per what? The gun deaths per what?
It said that gun homicides per day, if each country had the same population as in the U.S., they adjusted it for, like, I think in here.
Yeah.
Per thousand, per, you know,
whatever. 100 grand in Luxembourg?
100,000?
Yeah. But I'm just simply saying, you know, no other Western country comes close. All right. If anybody wants some statistics or help from the web with their rebuttal, my suggestion, since we do have some time, let's go to about a 7-minute limit. So please have your rebuttals taken care of and done, and I'll run a clock. So
they're not taking my gun.
Let's have at it.
Tim, could you put up a chart about how many murders per year were in the U.S.?
Murders per year by gun?
Yeah. Or gun deaths per year in the U.S.? The history, like the last 50 years or 20 years?
It's been pretty high.
What's around? I think it's around 12 grand.
Gun deaths per capita?
No, they're just gun deaths, gross number. Gun deaths per year in the United States, history.
Let's see if we can find something quickly here for you.
There's a lot of people here.
Gun violence by the numbers. Here we go. We'll find something.
Go to images and see if you find.
Where at?
Yeah.
I can. All right, images.
That was. Gun.
Let's just go right here to the top. Search part in Google, where it says right here.
Well, it's only 3 years.
Well, let's just go here. See if we can find a chart.
That's kind of all the current stuff.
Right.
What do you mean?
Annual gun homicides in the U.S.
Who cares what happened years ago?
How's that?
So it's pretty regular, around 11,000.
No, 33,000.
Total.
Yeah.
Homicide, suicide, unintentional legal intervention, undetermined. Go ahead with your rebuttal.
Okay. Well, one thing I'm going to hold Trump to, which I like, is I like stop and frisk. I don't give a damn about constitutional rights. I don't carry a gun around. Bring a cop in here and frisk everybody. I don't care. Could you imagine how dangerous this restaurant would be if every one of you guys carried a gun in here? A handgun.
It would be safe.
All the, oh, yeah, we'd be safe. Yeah, there would be one accident.
It would be if I had a gun, right?
Yeah, have Heather had a gun every night.
No, everyone else, but not her.
She's too dangerous.
So my point is that Charlie's nuts. Charlie wants to take every gun out of every person's cold dead hands, warm dead hands. Charlie, you're not going to take every gun away from every moron.
and every idiot and every gangster in the United States. Period.
Why?
What? Oh, come on in and give you. You're not. They already paid a carload of cold cash for gutter guns.
I've done it elsewhere.
Oh, yeah. Sure, Americans are going to bring in their guns. You're nuts. There's hundreds of millions of guns out there. They're going to stay in people's houses. You're not going to collect them.
Mothers of the United States.
But the worst thing that ever happened was publicizing that it was fine to carry guns. My point again, if everybody in here was had a gun on them right now, do you know how dangerous it would be? It would ask, what if somebody was in a bad mood? Somebody didn't like me. They'd shoot me. Good. Heather would shoot a customer.
Oh, I'd shoot all of them.
Yeah, you can't have a gun.
Somebody would be fondling a gun in the other room, and it would go off, and Charlie would get killed. So my point is the Second Amendment says you can own a gun, you can bear a gun, but it does not say anything about bringing a gun out in public. You can have it privately in your own home. The minute you cross your property line, it should be illegal. So.
Well, they're going to bring it out in a fight.
No, you keep it in your friggin' house.
That doesn't stop. You got an argument when you...
Well, yeah, they can, but they're breaking the law. I want cops to shoot them on sight.
My loony neighbor, I get in an argument with him. He says, I'll show you, you lucky.
Where's the fight going to happen?
He's going to go in and get his gun.
Okay, and if he walks out of his property, then he's breaking the law.
Oh, I'm going to have to tell him that. Sir, you're breaking the law.
Well, he's going to shoot. You're not going to be on his property.
I'm warning you. You're breaking the law by pointing that gun at my head.
Yeah. And then have the cops come over and shoot him.
Putting that gun at my head is against the law, sir.
Anyway, I'm going to hold Trump to it because he's going to stop and frisk everybody. So I think that's a pretty cool idea that Donald Trump came out with.
You have to get weapons out of the community.
No, you're not going to collect a half a billion guns in America.
Why not? You're crazy.
But it should be illegal to bring a gun off your private property into the public domain. Anyway, I worked in some of the most dangerous neighborhoods in the city of Chicago, the most dangerous. By the way, who knows who has the worst per capita murders in the United States? Anybody know?
Psychiatrists?
You mean the cities?
Yeah. Chicago, the stupid media, local and national, blame Chicago for having the worst murder rate. Who has the worst murder rate?
Urban areas, I think.
Okay. No, what city?
Detroit.
Detroit's up in the top 5 or 6.
No.
St. Louis?
St. Louis is up in the 5 or 6.
Very Indiana.
Very good. Baltimore's in the top 5 or 6.
Washington, D.C.?
They're up in like the top 10. Very good.
Yeah. Very good.
I have a chart up.
You didn't bring a chart up, did you, on that?
List of cities by murder rate.
That's international. I don't want that.
Well, per capita?
Per capita.
Someplace in Alaska?
New Orleans, number one.
Yeah.
Wow. Per capita.
Yeah.
Chicago has a third of New Orleans.
Wow.
Philadelphia's higher. Miami's higher than Chicago per capita. So when you hear some talking head on one of the local stations or in the national media talk about how bad it is in Chicago, or you hear Trump or Republicans, they're telling lies. Because there's many, many, many other cities that have much worse murder rates than Chicago does. Gross numbers, we have the highest, and New York and Los Angeles are doing something, obviously. Right? They are more wealthy cities than Chicago. They can hire a lot more police.
Didn't even make the top 30 list.
Yeah.
East St. Louis was the countdown of 30 murder capitals in America.
Is this domestic?
No, this
no
is a...
talking about this, goddammit.
What?
What I'm going to say. You're not talking
Hold on,
about.
Hold on. Will you get 7 minutes? Hold on. For more. Okay.
You got to occupy the whole thing. Go ahead.
But Charlie can't up here talk for an hour.
Let him go when we're done.
Well, I was the speaker.
Yes. Okay, why don't we go ahead.
Okay, so my question, my comment here is there's no reason to carry a gun in public. Absolutely no reason. I support the Second Amendment. I think guns should stay in people's houses safely. We can't roll that back, but there's no reason to bring a gun into public.
I live in a bad neighborhood.
Okay, how many people here are veterans? Andy?
I'm a veteran.
Tim? Okay. That many veterans, great.
Right.
Okay, this summer when the weather breaks, this spring, there's thousands of veterans in Standing Rock up in the Dakotas. Okay, Big Oil, Big Wall Street is there, and they have guns that are locked and loaded. And there's protesters. There's Native Americans there. There's protesters, there are water protectors. There are veterans there. And veterans have guns.
No.
They're not sitting up in the Dakotas with dozens and hundreds and thousands of guns? Okay.
Let's move on.
Okay, my point is...
No, they don't know how to guns up there.
Oh, they don't know how to guns okay. there. If you're a veteran, if you're a part of the United
All right.
States military... Michael...
It's a peaceful
if you're part of the United States... Wait, is a free speech more of a forum? I
yeah, but
talk?
The time's starting to get tick down.
Yeah, but it's a peaceful nonviolent protest.
No, it's not. It's not going to be when Big Oil and Trump and the military start killing people in the Dakotas. Are you veterans? Do you think you would shoot at other Americans?
All they did was spray them with water.
Okay.
No, rubber bullets and bombs.
Let's get on to our next speaker, okay?
I'm not done.
Evil fire.
Your 7 minutes are up.
Anyway, that's all I got to say, and I'm disappointed you guys are giving me the bums rush here.
Well, no, but thank you for saying what you said.
Well, when Charlie comes up here with all these lies... I got a counter.
Yeah.
All this misleading stuff. We're going to collect half a billion guns.
Yeah.
Yeah, right.
Okay. In the Philippines, they put up big 55-gallon drums, and everybody had to put their guns in.
Wait till the Second Civil
okay,
War starts
let
in
go.
Dakotas.
This summer. 7 minutes, my friend.
We won't take that long. 100 years from now, what we're talking about... A 100 years from now, and I don't know why we haven't done this already, why hasn't there been devised something to disable someone without killing them? It doesn't exist right now. It doesn't exist because I guess the gun people, they want their guns. But at some point it's going to happen. That means policemen don't have to carry a gun. You kill me or I kill you. It's not set up that way. Yeah, the idea is to disable someone so you can take over whatever the danger is and take care of it. That's all you have to do. So within 100 years, that will take care of a lot of the problems, the whole gun thing. Now the problem is in our minds. We still have to worry about that. That will take longer, I think. But the first thing is, don't get into this gun thing. It's a very crude way to handle it.
Yeah. Okay. Next.
That was it? I could have talked longer.
It's all right. We get some free speech from Sid.
Yeah,
7 minutes.
Hey, I'm going to go up there again.
7 minutes.
Yeah, whatever.
Use the mic, please.
Yeah. Well, one of the reasons that Chicago has such a high crime rate is the unemployment level. They talk about New York and Los Angeles. And Chicago has more murders per capita than these two cities put together. But the reason is there's not as much unemployment in New York and Los Angeles as there is in Chicago. And of course, one of the only ways people can make a living these days is by selling dope. And people go out in the street and sell dope in order to get the next meal or pay their rent. This is the only way they could accomplish that. So they go out and do it. but it's never talked about, and that is getting jobs into these inner cities. If they had jobs and the people had some help, they could get ahead in life, there wouldn't be such random killing as there is today. And if you look in the United States, we were in 7 different wars. So when we talk about people having guns and violence as a way to solving problems, what does the United States do? It tries to solve its problems with guns and war. Look at the Middle East. We're in all these different countries in the Middle East, and if we weren't, what happened is the gun lobby and the manufacturing of guns wouldn't be making as much money. So the Republicans and some Democrats, I don't know what percentage, are not trying to do away with guns. They don't want to test if somebody has a mental disease. They don't want no test in order for them to buy guns. And the Republicans just rejected that. If somebody has a mental illness, they can still get guns. The United States, if didn't have weaponry, would be in the deepest depression you ever seen in your life. It make 1929 look like a tea party. If it didn't sell all these weapons for these gun manufacturers and the airplane manufacturers and the tank manufacturers and the cannon manufacturers, the United States would be in the worst depression we ever had. And that's not good for the ruling class.
Okay, so that's good. We need guns for the
ruling class wants to stay in power. So if they find another country we can have a war with, we have a war. NATO is right on the border of the Crimea. And NATO is an aggressive pact formed by the United States for world domination. We had the Third Reich, and now we have the Fourth Reich. The Fourth Reich is the United States. And they don't try to do anything about it. Nobody in Congress wants to stop the wars, or in the Senate, or even the presidency. They always find enemies. You're not an enemy under this bed. Let's look. We'll find an enemy under that bed. And they want to have an enemy with Russia and China now. Well, as long as you got imperialism, and that's what you have, is imperialism in the United States, you're going to have wars. Not only are you going to have wars, but you're going to have people in the government looking to make more wars. And if you want to solve the problem in Chicago, we have to solve the problem of the United States.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Imperialism.
All right, what Sid was talking about is there's... Go ahead. Okay. Just a brief thing, $13.5 billion in annual revenue for gun and ammunition manufacturing industry, $3.1 billion annual revenue of gun and ammunition stores with a $478.4 million in profits. Go ahead, when you're ready, go ahead.
Well, I agree with some of what was said concerning the fact that we need to do something to bring guns under control, and that big business indeed has found it as an easy way to make money. But NATO was set up, as some of you have seemed to have forgotten, to stop Stalin from taking over Western Europe. And the idea that it's an aggressive alliance is all a lot of socialist hogwash, and it's not one with which I have much sympathy. And when you throw into it that the Russians just marched into Crimea, they're busy fomenting trouble in Ukraine. I'm sorry, what is it that they expect? That we're all going to go around cheerfully playing, here we go gathering nuts in May or some such thing? No, or that we're all going to start playing tiddlywinks? No, I don't think so. Thank you.
Thank
Okay. Who else has a rebuttal?
No one has any objections to what I said.
What? Andy, you want to get up there and say something?
I collect all the guns. Next Tuesday at 12 noon.
But you know what? It's a good thing all the veterans have done something to Dakota.
Please.
Yeah, we're in the final stages of the rebuttal period, but again,
okay, Andy.
Look to other countries, which are showing us the way to avoid this kind of gun violence and carnage. There's good things. The press in America generally don't cover good things. That's why we don't hear about the success stories, like in Norway. The longest sentence you can get for murder, I think, is 21 years. They have a rehabilitation program. They don't have maximum security prisons. They have a whole different concept of how you treat lawbreakers. And so it's a society that believes that people have inherent value rather than our society looking at certain segments of people that are considered, as Henry Kissinger, I believe it was, said of the people, the average person in the army, military men are just dumb animals to be used up and thrown away. We're expendable. Many Americans are looked upon by the owners of this country, the rulers now, as being expendable. So those are the kind of issues we have to address if we're going to make any progress. If we don't address those issues, like someone just said, there's an article on the internet about 2 weeks ago that says, you want to know why there is so much inner city violence in Chicago? Well, take a look at the idea that if you have young black men that are not in school or not in jobs trying to survive in an area where there's no jobs, you get people trying to scrounge a living together any way they can, selling drugs, selling whatever they can. That's what we've got in Chicago. Chicago has been decimated with the loss of decent paying jobs. And another thing in our country, which almost nobody talks about, this fight for $10 or fight for 9 or 10 or fight for $12 an hour. $12 an hour is not a living wage in Chicago. That's a homeless shelter wage. The Chicago Sun-Times published an article on it about 8 years ago. They said if a woman has a child and is living in a homeless shelter because she lost her home, to get out of a homeless shelter and rent a place and have gas and oil for her 10-year-old car that's already paid for so she can get back and forth to work, she needs somewhere between $18 and $22 an hour. This $10, $12, $15 an hour is a fantasy that we've allowed ourselves to be browbeaten into over the years by the billionaire predators, as I call them, that own the corporate media. And if any of you want a real eyeful about what the corporate media is doing, pick up a copy of the current 2017 edition, 2017, it says Censored 2017. The book came out in October. But Barnes & Noble wouldn't make it available and wouldn't order it until after the election. Because that book, one of the top 25 stories in that book this year, is the deal that the media made with the Clinton campaign. Way back when Bernie was first starting out, the Clinton campaign and the American media, the mainstream media, they struck a deal. They said, the media told Hillary, you do some good things for us after you get in the White House, and we will bury Bernie for you. We will, when he's winning primaries everywhere, we'll report him as losing, which is what they did. The American people, for 15 months, we got mainstream coverage of how Hillary was ahead, Hillary was winning. Well, it was total, utter bullshit. This country voted in massive numbers with their feet, rallies, people turned out like this women's rally in Washington and all over the world right after Trump got elected. The people are voting in demonstrations. You know, we had a clear choice of a winner for president this year. He would have been the choice of probably 70-80% of the American public, both Republicans and Democrats, compared to whoever else was running. Bernie was the clear choice, and the media buried him. The corporate press, you know, so we have, and Greg Palast talked about how the media then began to switch over to helping get Trump elected. Trump got several $1 billion worth of free advertising and coverage. If he had to pay for that news coverage, it would have been up in the billions. It was wall-to-wall Trump, 24/7, the whole thing. So, and what they're not telling us is that Trump is not the president. Trump is a puppet. He is a total puppet with the billionaire predators that ran the Bush-Cheney campaign for 8 solid years. That corporate criminal enterprise we had for 8 dark years is now surrounding Trump and giving him a list of appointees. There's, I don't know how many articles he said. They're finding the meanest, nastiest, ugliest fox they can find to guard the hen house on each of these federal appointees. If you're a Christian and you believe in the principles that Jesus taught, and you judge people on the principles, pro or con, every one of Trump's appointees so far can be 100% considered 100% antichrist. Just the opposite of what Jesus would do. Help the sick, help the poor. No, let them die, make profits. This is where we are. And the press is not covering it. It's to those of you that have access to the internet, you should introduce yourselves to a website called Common Dreams. CommonDreams.org is one of the best progressive websites that puts up the best of the best breaking news stories every day. You want to be informed of what's going on in America, look at Common Dreams. Now, you can't find out anything about 9/11 there. They won't cover that. You can't find anything about the end of the AIDS epidemic and the fraud that that's become. Other countries are reporting, incidentally, that the lawsuits coming up through the courts, the so-called AIDS epidemic is now considered the largest, costliest, most embarrassing, lethal medical hoax in human history. A lot of people died, but they didn't die of AIDS. They were poisoned by the AIDS doctors. They were given fatal chemotherapy poison in capsules that have been renamed an antiviral drug. They murdered 300,000 in this country alone, and the drug companies are making big profits. Billionaire predators in the drug companies kill 2 birds with 1 stone, make billions, and get rid of unwanted citizens that are unpopular in some areas. So the billionaire predators target certain groups of people periodically. And those of you that may have had friends involved in the issue of trying to prevent abortion, for one thing they haven't been talking about in 30 years, you never hear any talk about what other countries teach young people. You can teach certain kinds of birth control where there's never an unwanted pregnancy. There's no reason for an unwanted child to be born. You can eliminate 99% of all abortions by not having those pregnancies occur in the first place. It's very easy. The knowledge is widespread, but not here in America. We have what we have. So if you want to see what kind of a bubble where the media is maintaining us in, get a copy or look it up on your smartphones or internet. Project Censored has a website that has, Steve put up Project Censored?
That's exactly what I'm going to do.
Yeah, Project Censored has the last 20 years archives of stories, and the new Project Censored book is just loaded with the total stolen election, the fraud we've been inundated with from the media in the last 2 years about the political campaign, and a bunch of other things too. And they talk about good things that are happening. How many people know, can anybody tell me what's the number one country in the world for going solar as fast as they can?
China.
Denmark.
China. Israel.
Keep guessing.
Israel.
Bangladesh.
No.
Bangladesh is number one in the world in putting up solar panels per capita faster than any other country on the planet. Solar is dirt cheap now, way cheaper than fossil fuel anywhere on the planet, any kind of fossil fuel. Even if it bubbles up out of the ground, it's cheaper to go solar now With that coupled with the new LED light bulbs and new high-efficiency small refrigerators, these things are revolutionizing living conditions all over the planet. Nothing in our news here, but they will tell us about Kim Kardashian. I tell people if they didn't keep me updated on whether Lindsay Lohan was going back to drug rehab, I don't know what I'd do with myself. I mean, we need to know these things every week, right?
If it bleeds, it leads.
If it bleeds, it leads. That's the term. Yeah. And of course, the Censored News, the Journalism School of Sonoma State, they teach journalism students how not to get fired and blackballed if you're going to be a journalist in America. Nice. Because you can't talk about certain things on the air, or they just fire you and you're gone.
Right.
And that, you know, so the 2017 edition is the 40th anniversary of Project Censored. That's been up and running for 40 years. And a lot of the people that work at Barnes & Noble don't even know the book exists. That's how widespread and pervasive and complete the coordinated blackout is on that book that's published every year, and the project itself that's been running linked to other colleges. So there's a wealth of good information, but start with Common Dreams. If you haven't looked at that site, just look, they post the best of the best news stories throughout the days. It's like a breaking news site that's just the opposite of Fox News. They post real news rather than fake news.
Corporate media.
And for those of you that were wondering, there was an article on the Smirking Chimp a couple of days ago. They described what Trump is doing. He said, Trump is not just feeding us bullshit. It's way beyond bullshit. What Trump is doing, he said, the official term is fuckery. F-U-C-K-E-R-Y. He said, Trump is fucking with us. He's not just feeding us bullshit. There's a book from the Nixon era, a new book describes the term that was coined during Richard Nixon's time. It was called rat fucked. Rat fucked. That's the term. For dirty tricks, all kinds of things in the middle of the night, censored. Yeah, well, the people that learned the dirty tricks from Richard Nixon have gone way beyond, and now we've got the people surrounding Trump. So here we are. Log on to Common Dreams, and
I've been
comparing notes. You got it up here?
I got Smirking Chimp. I had Common Dreams up earlier.
The Smirking, my favorite sites, the Common Dreams is the first one. I check Smirking Chimp, and then Truthout. Truthout.org has articles on the environment and all kinds. Truthout and Common Dreams are kind of in competition with each other to post the best of the best every day. And then these stories go viral and they're cross-linked. But at any one of these three sites, you log into them first and you'll see something that'll show up there and then just go viral out on the internet. So there's a whole wealth of good information out there if you know where to look for it. And it's easy, you know, those sites are easy to log on to. They're printer friendly. If you got a printer, you can print a 2-page article. Oh, yeah, I'll have some more articles in a couple of weeks. On February 18th, we'll have some good handouts for people.
All right.
Okay, anybody else have a rebuttal?
Charlie, you want to make a few closing remarks?
Yeah.
And
tell us how you're going to collect the handbook.
We'll adjourn the college early tonight if people want to get home early.
It's about 8:16. Go ahead and close
that. Don't worry. Make it illegal to have it gone outside.
We got time. All right, any final parting questions?
Can I say a few words?
All right.
How we can revive people. Yeah, they got sites, stories like that every day.
Okay, yeah. Good stuff.
I think seven, hi, good evening. I think 7 minutes is too long. I think the 3 minutes, then you could come up a second time. See? You can't.
Use the mic if you don't mind.
If you can't get to your point in 3 minutes, you won't do it in 7 minutes. So 3 minutes and you come up twice. And also about this, somebody mentioned about the job. The jobless rate causes violence. And I think a teenager should be forced to go to school. They're 18 years old, you know. If they get caught, they should send them out to the junk to our pay order. He's got a tent set up in the desert, and it's a little rough. Send them in for 6 months, and they'll straighten out. They get You have to work about 8-10 hours a day. They sleep in tents on the desert over there. I think it's Arizona. And I left my notes there. But today, I left my notes over there. I have a couple of those.
Are these your notes?
But yeah, well, the Super Bowl's coming tomorrow. Actually, we should mention something about the Super Bowl.
Says Trump is Christ.
What? Trump is what?
Christ.
God help us. The second coming.
He's a fucker. Fucker. Okay,
Trump is Christ.
Trump is Christ. Last week I came late. I thought we started here. I'll be early. I'd get to 7:30. Today I knew we could start at 6. I tried to get here, but I came about an hour and a half late, you know. None of us will be here in 100 years. Somebody mentioned it. In 100 years. The Super Bowl. On a bus, I told him, I said, hope that Atlanta wins. I don't want Tom Brady to win his fifth Super Bowl season. And he's too beautiful for my liking, you know. He's married to a supermodel, and she earns more money than he does. And speaking of beauty, Melania, the first lady now, she probably will be the most beautiful first lady of all time. And it's my humble dogmatic opinion that Trump will be the greatest president of all time. He might be knocking Trump, but he loves his country. He's a multi-billionaire. He doesn't need his job. He's slumming in the White House. I heard he thought he was going to stay in the Trump Tower instead of Washington, instead of the White House. And sometimes I think that Trump is out to get assassinated.
Could be.
Yeah. I think he's going to be assassinated. And just like this guy in Poland, this Populusko, this Prince Populusko, he wants to be killed by the communists. He provoked the communists. He was killed. He wanted to be martyred, so-called. And that's about it. Last week I came here. He had to sign a no to fascism. Now, which would you rather be, a fascist or under fascism or under communism?
None of the above.
You got it. I asked a couple people. I said, communism. But if you're under fascism, you know that things are going wrong, see? So you're planning to get out of the regime. But once you're under communism, it's like a frog in nice warm water. The water gets hot, warmer and warmer, and that frog gets his goose cooked. And under socialism, it's worse than fascism. The frog gets his goose cooked under socialism. Neither above is right.
Okay.
Hey, Bernie was a socialist. Yeah, we need some socialists.
If there are no other rebutters, I would just like to ask, did you guys think we had a worthwhile night at the college?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I like your fact-checking demo here.
All right. Charlie, any parting remarks?
Yeah.
All right. After Charlie's done, we'll adjourn to college.
Any parting questions?
Yeah, how are we going to collect half a billion guns?
Just like they did in the Philippines. They put 55-gallon drums at intersections, and everybody had to put their guns in there. Very simple. And they think they collected the guns in Australia. You can't have... You have to have a gun-free zone. You can't compromise. I mean, it's whimsical to say, well, my loony neighbor can have all the weapons he wants, assault weapons, but promise, sir, please promise that you'll keep it inside the house or your backyard. He says, okay, I promise you, Charles, I won't bring it outside my house, ever.
If he does, call the cops.
Now, if I get into a dispute with my loony neighbor, and let's say I give my opinion of him, which upsets him,
What do you think he is going to do?
He pulls out guns to all the cops.
Oh! This is why you need gun-free zones. And you have to, if community saw, the one thing I wanted to talk about, you can't compromise on this. There's no, there's, since guns are like death or no death, you know, it's not like, they're like medium guns, you know. That they just don't exist. You know, it's like yes, no, yin and yang, guns, no gun, you know, bullet, no bullet, you know. You're having a difficulty understanding this. You know, bullet hole, no bullet hole. But, the thing you're saying, you find it inconceivable that we will not confiscate guns. Do you realize where we began on the gun issue, sir? Do you know there was no such thing as gun checks or registration anywhere? And they fought it bitterly? You know? The only thing you might have had to do was buy a hunting license. And they fought that, as a matter of fact, they're on the run. And they know the writing's on the wall. You cannot have 33,000 deaths. Do you realize that? What happened in Vietnam? How many soldiers did we? You're talking about veterans. What was the fatality in Vietnam?
58,000.
We get 33, 36,000 every year. How long is Vietnam? 10 years?
Something like that.
Yeah. We achieve that every year. 33,000. Half that, if you wish. That's just not going to go on. I think, yes, it's going to be incremental. It's not going to be easy. The industry has money. I think they perceive that the clock is ticking. It's already a few minutes to midnight for them. And there's a, the last notion that they have is instilling fear in the people that there are terrorists who are going to show up and harm you. Well, what's the probability of your getting hurt by a terrorist in the United States?
Very low.
Right. It's like getting, you have a greater probability of getting struck by lightning 3 times.
Once is enough.
But I mean, this required, the odds are so much against this that the need of weaponry, you know.
What about mentally deranged?
You know, what's that?
What about by a mentally deranged?
Well, that's what I'm saying. Well, this is their argument. This was the debate this week. I don't know if you followed this. Are you familiar with what went on this week? Throughout the campaign, and their new argument is that if you control, guns are a mental health issue. So you have to control the mentally ill. To keep the mentally ill from getting guns, and everything will be all right. But now this week, they eliminated legislation. It's a rather obscure one that the Social Security Administration has identified certain citizens. And they wrote it that if you're one of these individuals, they, it's like 3% of the population are basically mentally ill, are incapable of handling their own personal finances, is the criteria they use, you will not be allowed access to own a gun. And they removed that prohibition so that even though these are people who are incapable of managing their own personal finances, they can, with what money they have, go out and buy a gun. So they said all along, this would be, if you think a mental health approach, but then again, the fallacy about the mental health approach is that, and I'm sorry to say this, some of the people that have guns, to me, are mentally ill. Because it's an inappropriate response to anxiety. Anxiety is a fear of the unknown. So by purchasing a weapon, you feel the world is threatening. So you buy a weapon, and maybe this is over-intellectualizing, you buy a weapon, and that reduces anxiety. So these people are, but it's an inappropriate response because you shouldn't feel the world is threatening. That's what I mean. The world is, it is to a certain extent. There's some personality theorists that maintain that. But if you feel it to that extreme, that you have to have weapons to respond to it. So in essence, what's really scary about guns is the very people who buy guns, at least from my way of thinking, are the very people who should not have guns. This is what's amazing about this. The very individuals who get weapons or argue for them are the very individuals who want to keep from having guns. And he wants to say, oh, well, we'll get this crazy guy and he'll just promise never to use his gun. His arsenal. His assault. My neighbor's got a dozen assault weapons. Do you promise not to use those? Okay. All right. Thank you.
What do we do on Tuesday?
I promise.
What happens?
I promise I won't shoot. I won't shoot Charles.
What happened when Trump starts killing citizens? In the
one of the worst things that could ever happen to some of this stuff.
I was here late. I thought he started late. Last week was the feast day of Thomas Aquinas. His feast day was the 28th. And he said any abortion up to 1 month for any reason. After 1 month, no abortion.
What does that have to do with God?
And Aquinas said the best ruler is a good old wise king.
And we're
good old wise king.
And we're adjourned.
All right.
Tim, what happened to our guy?